Welcome back to Dentistry Unfiltered, and the topic for today is halitosis. The mouth is a home to hundreds of bacterial species, the good as well as the bad. Bad breath is a common complaint by a handful of our patients, not just the morning breath but chronic bad breath. The Latin word halitosis can be broken down into halitus, which means breathed air, and osis, which implies a condition or pathological alteration. Fetor oris, fetor exor, oral malodor and bad breath are synonyms or other terms which are used to describe halitosis. In simple terms, it is most often caused by buildup of bacteria in the mouth because of any gum disease, food accumulation or plaque. Although this classification by Yukagi in 2000 has not been universally accepted by all the experts in the field, there is a general agreement that halitosis can be categorized as genuine halitosis, which can be either physiological, meaning in which there is no readily apparent disease, or pathological, which occurs as a result of an infective process of the oral tissues. The second category is pseudohalitosis, which is a condition in which there is an absence of halitosis but the patient believes that they have a bad breath. And lastly, there is halitophobia, that is not physiological but psychological type, meaning severe fear of bad breath that doesn't exist or it can be seen in patients after treatment of either genuine or pseudohalitosis. The other terms that can be used while describing bad breaths are the intermittent or transient type of halitosis, that is the morning breath or after eating food such as garlic, tea and coffee, or the chronic type, that is the long-term persistent bad breath. Now coming to the causes of bad breath, this can be further bifurcated as intraoral or extraoral causes. The most common cause, that is the intraoral cause of bad breath, include poor oral hygiene, that is bacteria that build up on your teeth, particularly between them, as well as on your tongue and gums, can produce unpleasant bad breath. The periodontal pockets provide an ideal environment for the growth of bacteria that release large amount of volatile sulfur compounds, which explains why patients with periodontal disease often complain of bad breath. The bacteria that are associated with volatile sulfur compounds are P. gingivalis and P. intermedia. Next, coming to habits such as chronic smoking, alcohol intake and tobacco abuse. Another less talked about cause is dry mouth, that is oral dryness, which occurs during sleep when salivary flow and oxygen availability is low. This environment promotes more buildup of bad anaerobic bacteria and formation of volatile sulfur compounds. Remember the mnemonic PhD. Now coming to the extraoral causes, which include diet, certain drugs such as nitrates, chemotherapeutic drugs, tranquilizers can also lead to bad breath. Certain upper or lower respiratory infections such as tonsillitis, sinusitis, bronchitis, even people with diabetes can have bad breath that smells more fruity or acetone-like, of related to the ketones. Patients with acid reflux or gastrointestinal problems often complain of acidic breath. And patients with kidney failure may have breath that smells like ammonia or urine. Patients with serious liver diseases can complain of breath that smells more musty or like garlic and rotten eggs. Lastly, the most serious of all, presence of any malignancy. After tooth brushing and flossing, the most important step is tongue cleaning. The tongue surface is the main strong odor-forming site in the mouth. The anterior part of the tongue is rougher because of the high number of these innumerable depressions in the tongue surfaces are ideal niches for bacterial adhesion and growth. The bacterial load located on the posterior dorsum of the tongue is the principal origin for malodorous compounds. This part of the tongue is difficult to reach and exhibits a number of units that roughen this region. Interestingly, the role of the tongue coating in malodor production probably resides in the composition of the tongue coating rather than the thickness or extent of the coating. Now, what are exactly these volatile sulfur compounds? These are compounds produced through the bacterial metabolic degradation of food debris, desquamated cells, salivary proteins, dental plaque and microbial putrefaction. Some examples include hydrogen sulfide, methyl mercaptan, dimethyl sulfide and also other compounds such as indole, scatol, putrescine and cadaverine. This figure enlists the odoriferous compounds that give rise to halitosis. Remember the mnemonic My Head PC has a very powerful broadband internet. Let's come to the diagnosis. This includes direct methods and indirect methods. Direct method includes direct sniffing of bad breath, that is by the individual themselves. The most simple of all, that is cupped bad breath. A person can evaluate the odor emanated from their mouth by cupping their hands over their mouth and breathing through the nose. Next is wrist lick test. One can extend their tongue and lick their wrist in a perpendicular fashion. The presence of odor can be judged by smelling the wrist after 5 seconds at a distance of about 3 centimeters. And spoon test, that is a spoon can be used upside down or simply scrape and scoop the debris from the back of the tongue. The odor is judged by smelling the spoon after 5 seconds at a distance of 5 centimeters. Next is dental floss test, that is an unwaxed floss can be used and passed interdentally. Remove the floss and smell it from a distance of about 1 inch. These are methods of self-assessment, that is essentially how one can themselves objectively determine whether one has bad breath or not. A more professional form of direct method of diagnosis is organoleptic assessment. It is a gold standard sensory test that is subjective as it is based on the examiner's perception of a subject's breath. As you can see in this photo, a privacy screen is placed between the examiner and the subject with an open-ended plastic tube that is 10 centimeters in length. The subject exhales slowly from one end. An examiner judges the odor from the other end. Similarly, nasal breath can also be determined and the examiner will score the subject's breath in a scale of 0 to 5. That is none to severe malodor. It is easy to perform but has poor objectivity and reproducibility. Another subcategory of direct assessment is determination of the odoriferous sulfur containing compounds with the help of gas chromatography. It is performed with an apparatus that is equipped with a flame photometric detector. It is considered to be a gold standard that can quantitatively analyze the concentrations of volatile sulfur compounds. Other tools include the halimeter or sulfide monitors, the electronic nose and tongue sulfide probes. Lastly, the indirect methods, which essentially identify the odor producing microorganisms. Two most popular tests are the Bana test and direct field or phase contrast microscopy. And some authors have also described the reliability of saliva incubation tests. Now coming to the management of halitosis. Before any treatment is rendered, thorough history taking is a must. One must also keep in mind to correlate the symptoms of halitosis to clinical presentations and overall health of the patient. Identify the source or the predisposing factors and modify them. Also, it is important to confirm the diagnosis and determine the type of halitosis. Next, the exact treatment corresponding to the type of halitosis should be employed, as you can see in this photo. In these boxes, when you see the term TN, it stands for treatment needs. These have been categorized into 5 classes that provide guideline to the clinician while treating halitosis. Treatment need 1, that is in cases of physiological halitosis, requires reinforcement of oral hygiene simply. Treatment need 2, in cases with pathological halitosis, requires professional scaling and oral prophylaxis. Treatment need 3, in cases with extraoral causes of pathological halitosis, need to be referred to a medical specialist. And in treatment need 4, that is in patients with pseudohalitosis, need reassurance, professional instructions and education. Lastly, in TN5, that is treatment need 5, patients with halitophobia require psychological counseling. Finally, what is the treatment of halitosis? First is mechanical reduction of microorganism. That involves atraumatic tongue cleaning, tooth brushing, interdental cleaning by use of proxa brush, dental flosses, waterpik devices and professional scaling and root planing. Next, chemical intervention, that is chemical reduction of oral microbial load by use of antimicrobial dentifrices and mouthwashes such as chlorhexidine mouthwash in 0.2% concentration with cetylpyrimide chloride, essential oil mouthwashes, chlorine dioxide, triclosan and fluorides, hydrogen peroxide, which can act as neutralizing agents. Another treatment form can be masking the malodor with the use of oral mouth sprays, oral lozenges and chewing gums. Lastly, rendering the malodorous gases non-volatile is another form of treatment, which can be undertaken by using metal salts containing dentrifices like zinc chloride, strontium fluoride. I hope this video was helpful. Thank you so much for watching. Do like, share and subscribe to the channel Dentistry Unfiltered.